I'm just here to say welcome to British Science Week edition of Question Time, hosted by the British Science Association. My name's Hannah Russell. I'm the Chief Executive at the British Science Association, and it's my absolute pleasure to welcome you here this evening. Thank you to those in the audience for attending in person and braving the weather. And to those on the YouTube live stream, thank you for tuning in. It's great to have so many people with us, and we hope you enjoy the discussion. I've been really looking forward to this evening's discussion, partly because it is my first British Science Week as Chief Executive at the British Science Association, but also because helping young people to connect with science is something that I'm absolutely passionate about, and we need to get better at doing it. According to research that the British Science Association did last year, only 34%, so one in three approximately, 14 to 18 year olds in the UK think that science is relevant to their lives. Even more worrying, only 8% of young people can think of a scientist that looks like them, and only 12% think that scientists represent their views and their values. So while the title of our event is How Can We Help Young People Connect with Science, let's be clear, young people are not the problem. This evening, we're here to discuss how the science sector can better involve and include young people in the solutions. We want to dig deeper into the issues, find out what young people think, and it's great to have so many young people here with us, as well as hearing from people who work in other sectors like sport and the arts. We've had some great questions submitted in advance. I'm really looking forward to hearing the ideas and suggestions of the panel, who will be introducing themselves shortly. Before we start, I would like to say thank you to UKRI for their ongoing support, as well as to all of our British Science Week partners, including 3M, MSD, and Urenco. Now, I'd like to hand over to our president, Dr. Anne-Marie Imafidon, who's going to be chairing our discussion. Thanks, Anne-Marie.
Thank you very much, Hannah. I'm Anne-Marie, the president of the British Science Association. I'm also CEO at Stemette, and I'm going to be doing my best, maybe, Fiona Bruce impression this evening, although I've already lost points on the hair and the style. Please don't hold that against me. So we've got a fantastic panel assembled here, some brilliant questions in the audience as well. So I'm looking forward to getting a little bit deeper into this topic that we have of young people being able to engage with science. And as Hannah said, as our CEO Hannah said, you know, this isn't about fixing the young people, it's about solving the problem elsewhere, which is why most of us on the panel might not necessarily count as young people, but I'm not looking at anybody in particular. So let's begin with some introductions. We're going to go from your left to your right, which is our right to our left here on the panel. There we go. Bob, introduce yourself. Who are you and what do you do?
Yeah, my name is Bob Ward. I work at the London School of Economics and Political Science, which is full of economists and social scientists. But I actually did a geology degree, and I've been working in science for much of my time. And I'm also deputy chair of the London Climate Change Partnership, which brings all the organisations in London that are concerned about the impacts of climate change in the capital.
Thank you very much, Bob. Welcome, Bob. Michael.
Hi, my name is Michael Sulu. I'm a lecturer in engineering at University College London, and I have a sideline where I do a lot of science communication and a lot of equality work within higher education.
Thank you very much. Aisha.
Hi, I'm Aisha, an aspiring engineer currently studying further maths, physics, product design, and an EPQ on the impact of AI on the cybersecurity sector.
Fantastic, thank you. Ali.
My name's Ali Speechley. I'm a football coach and also a community champion for the FA in women and girls football. And I've just finished a 14 and a half year career in the civil service to join a London-based sports charity at the end of this month to help engage young people and adults in sport in their local communities.
Congratulations for you, but commiserations for the civil service, perhaps. And then George.
Thanks. Hello, I'm George Freeman, MP, and I'm the Minister for Science.
Fantastic. So that is our panel. We've got many questions for them. So we're going to start with one that's coming to us virtually from 10-year-old Blythe in Solihull. Let's roll VT.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity to ask my question. I'm Blythe, I'm 10 years old, and I'm from Solihull. My question to the panel is, How can we make science more accessible for children with dyslexic superpowers? I'm dyslexic myself, and I want to make science as fair and as fun for dyslexics as possible, because sometimes dyslexics think it's hard, and sometimes they think it's just right, no experiments. But all you've got to do is find the best of it, and I want to make that for all dyslexics, from the oldest dyslexics to the youngest ones that are learning about the world. So can we make science more about creativity? Thank you for everything again.
Thank you, Blythe. Fantastic question to kick us off here. Minister Freeman.
Thank you. Well, what a brilliant question and what a brilliant way to kick off British Science Week. And thank you for all that you're doing to host it. That's fantastic. I think there are three answers to that brilliant question. One is we need to remember, and all of us who get science, just tell it a bit more passionately, that science is, yes, it's labs and research and papers and diligence. But first and foremost, science is about imagining a different reality. It's science that drove the Enlightenment, science that smashed the tyranny of unaccountable dictators in Europe in the Middle Ages and superstition and religion. Science has driven the great progress of mankind. And we forget sometimes that it is fundamentally a creative process. It's about imagining a different way of doing things, solving problems. Secondly, I think for Blythe, we need to invest much more in the neuroscience of dyslexia and a whole raft of conditions. There's a phrase, you know, are you on the spectrum? The truth is we're all on the spectrum. And I dream of a day when we'll be able to help children. I had a bad stammer as a child. Help children understand you've just got strengths. They're different strengths. Some are very sort of A1, some are D10. I mean, I should never go anywhere near accountancy. And help people understand what their strengths are. And I think thirdly, remind everyone in school that to be a great entrepreneur, to be a great innovator, you don't need to be a great academic. Some of our most powerful innovators have been buccaneering dreamers who've changed the world. So there's enough in here for everyone, and I really hope, Blythe, you'll end up coming into science and innovation.
I think Blythe definitely is gonna make a mark on the world in some way or another. I mean, Ali, what has this looked like in sports? You know, how have you been able to support young people possibly with dyslexia, as dyslexic superpowers, as we heard there with Blythe, and engaging with things like football?
Yeah, I think what I loved most about what Blythe said was he described something that some people might see as a disadvantage as his superpower, and that's brilliant. And in my coaching, I always start from a strengths-based approach, because when you're learning something new, it can feel quite uncomfortable and you can feel quite insecure about it. And I don't believe in making someone feel even more uncomfortable and then expecting them to shine. So I think it's about recognising diversity and that different people learn in different ways. And getting the kids, when I coach, I get the kids themselves to come up with a lot of what we're doing, so that, because they, you know, if there's 12 of them, that's 12 different ideas rather than just my one idea of how to do something. So I think it's about embracing diversity and just coming up with different ways of connecting with people who are going to have different ideas.
Was there something that you wanted to add, Aisha?
I can't speak much on dyslexia, but I know that science, as George said, is fundamentally creative. And so one of my closest friends, she is going into biochemistry, and she's one of the most creative people that I know. And I know that she's going to find a way to combine those two aspects into her job in the future.
She sounds fab too. Michael, I mean, you're a lecturer in engineering. This idea of creativity versus maybe practical skills, is that something that you're able to value across your course? Ali spoke there about having 12 students who kind of come up with their own ideas. Is that how your lectures run?
No. But I think I do resonate with Blythe in the way that he has framed how dyslexia is his superpower. I think what we see, I think, within universities is we have a very narrow view of excellence. And I think if we were to broaden that view to encompass all types of neurodivergence is the word, we'd probably be way better at solving the problems that society has today.
Fantastic. Now, Bob, before I bring you in, there's an extra question from Michelle Gregson, who's unable to join us today, but from NCAD. And she is asking very specifically about studying arts and bringing a range of transferable skills that complement careers in science and options pathways. Some of you here might seen this when you were doing your GCSE options. You know, they often make it difficult for students to opt for both arts and sciences at GCSEs. Are there ways that you think, and you've seen maybe from across your work, that we can ensure that the arts and science aren't mutually exclusive pathways in schools?
Yeah, I think it's a big problem that the education system tends to still concentrate you into narrow pathways, particularly as you get further and further along in your career. And somehow you kind of become disconnected from the arts, from the humanities, from the social sciences. And the great problems we all face in the world, and what often motivates people who go into science, engineering, technology, medical careers at the moment, is tackling the big problems. And they require multidisciplinary approaches. And I think my advice to anybody who's studying a science career is remain broad, right? Having a breadth of knowledge is a real asset. And, you know, you can develop your specialist skills and remain broad. And I think that, you know, it gives you a different insight. If you understand history, if you understand how to communicate and connect with people through the arts, you get something special that will be very valuable in your career. Because scientists don't, I think, learn enough, quickly enough, that there's no use being a brilliant mind and having brilliant ideas if you can't get them across to people, if you can't communicate, if you can't connect with people. And you often learn through arts and humanities a different way of being able to connect with your audience, which is absolutely essential for kind of having a successful career and having the biggest impact through your specialist knowledge.
We're really fortunate, actually, to have Natalie Kerris. I think I'm spotting. Is Natalie here? No? Oh, or maybe not. Okay, Minister George,
well,
what were you going
to... To Bob's point, which I think is really well made, I was bowled over by this. Earlier last year, I had the privilege of going to Einstein's library, and I thought it was all going to be deep particle physics. And he had the complete works of Shakespeare. He had E.P. Thompson, The Origins of the English Working Class. He had Dostoevsky's Idiot, which really amused me. To your point, he was a broad thinker who could communicate. And if you've read the simple explanation of the theory of relativity, he was a brilliant communicator. And the ability to think clearly and communicate clearly is part of the science toolkit, I think.
Thank you. So we've got our next question from Xanthi Bavistock, who's from Deptford Green School. The microphone is going to come to you just so the folks at home can hear your fantastic question.
Does the panel think that the curriculum schools have recovered to cover at Key Stage 4 leads schools to filling students with facts rather than inspiring the next generation, and should this be reviewed?
Brilliant, lots of nodding across the panel. Who wants to pick this one up? Aisha, you might be closest to GCSEs on the panel. I don't know, there's something about you. You know, what's your take on this, filling you up with facts? Do you feel like you're full of facts?
They definitely do fill us up with just a lot of facts. And while some of it can be interesting, a lot of it, it's not the most interesting stuff in the world. And I understand that they can't make a curriculum that everyone will enjoy. But I think another problem comes in with the way we're tested, because some of the questions in the test aren't, like the way the questions are worded, usually it's not as easy as you think it would be. And they're usually not given as much information as you think you required. So sometimes it's like, okay, you're learning all this content, you're applying it in this test, but how does that work in the real world? How is this applicable to me later in life? So I definitely think there's a change, there needs to be a change there, and at least, if not the what we're taught, the way we're tested on it.
Fantastic point. Ali?
Yeah, I think that's really interesting, Aisha, and I think linked to that, and maybe linked to what we were just talking about around creativity, is I think there's something, I mean, it was a while ago that I was at school studying science, but one of the things that put me off it was that I felt like there was a right and a wrong answer. And that's probably why I went the route of the art. So I actually studied film at uni, just in terms of being broad. I didn't study sport at all. But I think when we're teaching science, we need to be creative so that kids don't feel like, oh, if I get this wrong,
that's the end of that route for me. So I think with testing, it's hard because in tests, there is a right and a wrong answer, isn't there? But how we go about teaching them that information of what's right and wrong, I think we need to create opportunities for them to explore it and actually get it wrong first, because science is about experimenting, right? Some of the best scientists didn't get it right first time, and that's how they found these, they discovered all these amazing things from getting something else wrong. So I think, yeah, there's space there for maybe how we teach science.
I think it's a great point. All of the best scientists definitely got something wrong, right? It's good for us to reflect on that. But also that idea of testing with a right and a wrong answer. We still manage to test in certain subjects where there isn't a right or a wrong answer. I remember that when I was at school in English, getting really frustrated. How do you know that this is good or not good? You know, what rules are you using? We've got some teachers in the audience. Do any of them want to chime in as you are the people purportedly filling students with facts? Yes, go for it at the back. The microphone's going to come to you.
Yeah, to a certain extent, I do sort of agree. I do find myself trying to fill students with facts and then also teaching to the test, but I think a lot of that is due to curriculum time. I don't know about other teachers, but I find my time very limited. And so in order to get students good marks on their test, needs must sometimes, you know, and so it's a balance between trying to inspire a love of science and then also trying to get them a good grade.
Some might say, don't hate the player, hate the game, right? So this, we might maybe look at what is good. What does good look like? Are there any examples we have across the panel of inspiring, good inspiring that's gone on within formal education systems? As you think, I run an organisation called Stemette. We run a lot of school trips. We go in. I think we have a lot of fun inspiring folks, getting them to see and broader, kind of wider from what's in the curriculum. We're not as bound, perhaps, as teachers, because we're not teaching to the test. But it can be quite nice to be able to bring different experiences, allow folks to see different settings of science, get to meet different types of folks, and that definitely inspires when you are trying to do the grunt work on the curriculum. Was there Michael?
Well, yeah, I think. Basically that. I think it should be the responsibility of institutions like higher education institutions, in industrial institutions, and then grassroots ones like yours, that should be there to support students and inspire them. Because, as we've already heard, there's too much for students to learn in a classroom, to at least while there's a transition towards changing the education system for better, we should be supporting it externally. Because I think we have the resource to.
Mm. Anyone want to add to that? Aisha?
For me, most of the inspiring things I've seen have been outside of school in organizations like the Stemettes. For me, one of the most inspiring people at the time I met was a woman called Mimi Unwosu. She's a civil engineer, and I'd heard about her through this program called Empowered Females in STEM that Upskill Me runs. And for her, she inspired me a lot because she seemed much more attainable than all those scientists and engineers you learn about and who are in history who did such great things. But to me, she was someone on a much smaller scale, someone who I could be in the future.
And Mimi's fantastic. She's actually one of the role models, I think, today on Smashing Stereotypes. There we are, very much on brand and on message. Thank you very much, Aisha. Now, Michael was just talking about the role that higher education has to play in inspiring. And so we've got audience questions from Samaya Ashrafi and Noor Mia from Bow School to this point on university. So let's get the microphone over to them and we'll delve into our next question.
How should universities help to inspire students to become the next generation of engineers and scientists?
How? I think most institutions are trying to do it, but not doing it very well because there's an issue of scale and reach. I would always advocate for not getting students to come to us and we should go to them. That's why there's an issue of scale and reach. But we need to meet people where they are in their communities. I think we need to engage with them the way they wish to be engaged with. I think you need to see a broad range of representatives of higher education institutions. There isn't a broad range of people in higher education institutions, so that's always going to be a problem. But I am a big fan and an advocate of going into schools, finding out what people want to learn, bringing in other people who can teach them that stuff, along with making sure you augment the current curriculum. You can't go in to a group of students who know nothing about space and teach them astrophysics, or aren't going to learn about space, because it's just a waste of everyone's time. But if they've done something and they're learning about space, then bringing in someone who's at expertise in astrophysics to teach them more about what would happen in a higher education setting is probably the best way to do it. So I personally am a biochemical engineer. We do a lot of kind of healthcare related research. So when students are learning about healthcare, that's when I would go in and try and explain the way that my discipline relates to healthcare. If students are learning about energy, I'd go in and do the same about my discipline. So I think it's really about meeting students where they are, augmenting what they're currently learning, and finding ways to try and scale it so that you don't just have individuals trying to make small amounts of impact in small spaces, but you can try and do it across the entire country.
Thank you very much, Michael. Now, Minister Freeman, you've been in the role for a month and 2 days. 18 months.
Yeah, I resigned last year for a bit.
Oh, right, okay, right. So maybe let's not talk too much about the history, but you know, universities, I'm sure, are within your remit. Is there any addition that you'd have? What do you like to see? What's the DSIT, if we can call it that, view on what universities?
Yes, I'm the Minister for University Research, not teaching. And if I may just take this question with Xanthes, because I think there's a point here about key stages. And yesterday I met a brilliant lady in Parliament who runs Lab Tots. So she goes into nursery schools and primary schools and does really fun plastics, chemistry, things that fizz and smoke. I mean, just get kids really early inspired by chemistry. And I think starting early is really important. I want to put a word in for facts, and great teachers make inquiring minds that love it when the facts then fit in. If you're trying to learn facts against a framework that doesn't make any sense, it's like cramming in. If there's a framework, then I think the facts just hang naturally. And I in so many subjects, my children are now 22 and 19. And I remember watching them through primary school. And in music, it seems to me like we're looking for Mozart, not looking for the musician in every child. And I remember my daughter crying when she failed her stage one piano. And it just put her off music. And that's no way to find Mozart or inspire people. And I look at ornithology and think, the way to get people interested in ornithology isn't to start learning the difference between the male and the female and the black tail. It's to say, do you know this bird flies around the world and comes back to the same area? And inspire the young mind to ask why. And then you inquire, and then you drive the learning. And I think at universities, to your point, I think it's a bit late then to be inspiring people to do science. We need to be starting much earlier. But what universities, I think, and FE colleges should really be doing is helping people who are doing science, human science, social science, or physical science, to discover careers. And there are too many scientists doing science and then going off to work in the city. And there are careers and jobs, but we're not nurturing them. And also reach out to communities nearby who perhaps aren't, you know, with schools and colleges that are feeling a bit left out. And that's why we've launched these innovation accelerators, Glasgow, Greater Manchester and West Midlands. And the key principle is that the cluster has to reach out to FE colleges and schools and share with the schools what's coming, so we inspire the next generation to come and get involved.
As a computer scientist that went to go and work in the city, I'm not going to take that dig personally, George.
There's nothing wrong with
So let's have a question from Laura Dana, Secretary. Oh, the second part of the question. Sorry. Okay.
How should universities invest time and support in nurturing young talent?
Okay, who wants to take this one? Bob.
So university, I think, don't do enough at the moment really to target young people who come from families who have no tradition of going to university and they just think it's not for them for whatever reason. Well, frankly, university should be for anybody who feels that they can benefit from it, right? That it should be everybody's opportunity to do that. And universities have a big role to play of sending people to schools and saying, university is a great place to really develop yourself, right? It's not only about learning subjects, you get something out of it. I've been talking to Aisha about what it might be like going to university and how daunting it is, but how many great opportunities you get out of it. You become a more rounded person by having that opportunity. It's not for everybody, but anybody who is good enough, can get the grades, is really motivated, should have that opportunity. And it shouldn't make any difference what kind of background you come from. But I also find that universities are full of people. I mean, the lecturers and the professors are people who spend their whole lives in universities, right? They don't have the broadest view of careers available, and the tendency to think, oh, well, I'm going to do a degree, then I'm going to do a master's, then I'm going to do a PhD, then I'm going to become a lecturer, and then I'm going to become a professor. Actually, a university degree is a great, great grounding for so many careers, because the one thing about science we do know is the most powerful way we have of understanding ourselves, the world around us, the universe. Everybody should have science because it's absolutely essential for having a developing a rounded life, whether you are a career scientist or not. We should all have an opportunity to study science because it's such a powerful tool that we can use in our daily lives. And that, universities have to be at the forefront of doing that. I just don't think we do a very good sales job at the moment on what a career in science really can be and what a university education can offer.
Thank you very much, Bob. We will come on to that sales job, actually, in the question that's coming. Aisha, I just wanted to hear from you. As a future university student, what would you like in terms of investment?
Get kids involved when they're young and keep them involved, because I've seen how if you make things relatable, things that kids will enjoy doing to get them into STEM, it's quite helpful. Because my younger sister, for a period of time, I had her coding on this website, and it was Minecraft themed, and she really enjoyed it. I told my friend's sibling about it, and they did it for a bit, and it got them in. They're enjoying it, but after they finished coding it, there was nothing for them to move on to. So eventually, she just came off of it, and that's that end of coding for her.
Not for her whole life, though, we're hoping, Aisha.
Hopefully not.
We're going to have a good end to that story. Okay, right. Our next question is from Loredana Sekriu from Deptford Green School. Where are you, Loredana? Awesome. Let's get the microphone.
Does the panel think that the way science and scientists are portrayed in the media leads to students feeling they're never going to be good enough, or that they would not find this a career they want to follow?
What a question. Who wants to pick this one up? The media.
I'll start.
Go for it.
I'll start, yeah. Yes. there's a very narrow view of what a scientist looks like. I think if you are a practicing scientist or engineer, what you will find is that there's a lot more diversity than you would see in the media. I think we are not portrayed as cool as, say, Anne-Marie is. but... Yeah, I think the real problem is that kind of narrow diversity of what a scientist looks like. And, you know, everyone, the age-old phrase of you can't be what you can't see is always going to then perpetuate the lack of diversity. There is more diversity than you would see, but it's always going to be an issue, I think.
As the one person wearing a pseudo-white lab coat, Aisha, what do you think?
I think it's not only about how people look, but also the personalities that are portrayed to be involved in science. Because in lots of like movies and shows, you see, oh, the science kid is the young, gifted kid, the kid who's done multiple research projects at the age of 10. NASA's recruited them, attempted to recruit them multiple times. Like, if you just... people see that, they think, oh, I'm not like that. I didn't get involved in science from such a young age. Like, take me, for example, I ended up in engineering by chance, I'd say, because my uncle was like, what do you want to do when you're older? I was like, I don't know. He said, how about you try engineering? And from then, I looked into it, and I found, no aerospace engineering, but I want to do engineering. So that's when I went in for it. But if I saw if I got into engineering based on shows, I would have been quite put off, because many of the people you see who get into engineering in the shows, they've been building projects since they were 2. They've been taking cars apart. They've been helping do this, that. For me, the only experience I had was really building furniture, and that's what got me there.
That's also still good enough, right? Yeah. Again, Aisha, I'm not going to take it personally because I had GCSEs age 2. But Ali, you know, when we talk about sports as well, there's been we had the This Girl Can campaign. That was media trying to portray something different about what we have. You know, what lessons can we learn, perhaps, from your field?
Yeah, and I think even if we just look quite recently at the Lionesses, the England women's football team, who were so successful in the summer, but I coached a programme in East London, and I coached a lot of young black and Muslim girls who really got behind that tournament and were really invested in it and really happy that England won. But they were like, A, all of these players look the same, and B, none of them look like me. They, you know, they felt like it was hard to truly invest in it because they didn't see themselves. And so how could they reach those heights if no one that looked like them had done it before? So I think it's really important. If the diversity is there, which we're saying we know it is, let's see it. In football, we have a big campaign. I have coached boys and men, but I've mostly coached women and girls. And we say, you know, if she can see it, she can believe it. And if she can believe it, she can achieve it. And I think it's just so important for everyone to see diversity, not just for young people to see it, but for adults to see it as well. So I think, yeah, there are lessons we can learn from sport. I think also linked to that conversation just now about engaging young people early. Mm-hmm. You know, in football, there's a program called Wildcats, which is literally, I mean, it's not even about football most of the time. It's about balloons and animal noises and jumping around and stuff, because it's about engaging children in physical activity. And then we start throwing the footballs in and seeing what they do with them. So I think it's important to, that's where you can get really creative, because I do feel for the teachers who have a really limited time to teach things. But like you said, Aisha, if we can engage them early in a really fun way, if they do start to drop out, so girls start to drop out of sport at around 13, but we know that now, so we've done things to address that. So same in science. If young people are starting to drop out at a certain point, which you guys will know better than me, let's research that and understand why that is. Ask the young people why they drop out. Probably not the people in this room, because you're here. But you know, like, let's understand it from the people we're trying to engage.
Balloons and animal noises. You got that?
Yeah, I got it. Can I just? I think the answer, Loredana, is yes, but it's getting a lot better. And I think if you asked a lot of people in society, draw me a scientist, I may be wrong, but I think they would draw you either an old bloke with a beard or a geeky young boy, I think. So I think it's quite male. So I think the stereotype is quite male and stale, but it's completely not what's going on in the sector. And I, as a minister, I get an incredibly privileged access. I recently had the whole board of GSK UK, all women. I was at the Max Planck Institute in Germany. The most prestigious fellowship has been awarded to a 29-year-old British biomedical scientist, a woman just done her PhD at Oxford. She's won 10-year funding, the pick of the institutes. I mean, we are bossing it, actually, in science, and women are doing brilliant work. I was with Google yesterday. They've got a black founders fund only for black and minority ethnic founders. I was in Coventry recently. We went up to celebrate the net zero battery cluster, which is quite white and traditional. And while we were there, through the local BBC journalist, her son started a nightclub and runs a coding company. And we discovered a completely underground, literally underground, sort of semi-invisible, largely black and minority ethnic coding cluster that nobody at Innovated really even noticed. So I think it's getting better, a lot better, but people like me and others need to tell the story. And the best people to do it are scientists. And the more we can get scientists out on the news, not ministers, to tell the story, the better. And actually, the Science Media Centre do really good work on this.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. So it's time for the next two questions. We've got two in one, or we're going to take two at the same time. So the first of the two is from Amelie Tillin-Eddy from Prendergast Ladywell School.
The question for the panel is, do you believe that girls are involved enough in the STEM sector in primary school to give them a passion for science and the confidence that they can succeed in STEM?
Thank you very much. The panel, you're going to hold that question. We've got it locked in. Okay, second question, Heather King, King's College London.
Should more be done to encourage young men to enter the predominantly female STEM-related fields of nursing and social care? And if so, what?
Okay, so where do we want to start, panel? Young men into nursing and social care and girls in primary school into STEM.
Well, I'll start if you want. Yes, is the answer, Heather. I'm going to come to Millie. What, I think, is the challenge. Firstly, we need more men teaching in primary schools. It's a huge imbalance, and I think some of the stereotyping starts there. We also need, in the health and care sector, to explain to people more that, you know, there's a stereotype there that nursing is quite a low-grade and care, sort of low-grade activity, and the real heroes of medicine are the largely male, white surgeons who do the great blue. Well, the truth is, and anyone who's had a diagnosis or has a family member, the real key is the care. It's the bedside care. It's the person who looks after you, who holds your hand, who explains, who... So I think we've got all the kind of worshipping of the wrong skills. I'm not saying surgery isn't important, but I think once we start to tell a different story about what health care really is, I think we'll start to change perceptions as well. And Millie, I completely agree with you. I think we do need to do more to get girls involved early. I think the Lab Tots program, I defy any girl under six not to do what I was doing yesterday and throw plastic around and make test tubes fizz and not think this is great fun.
But there's balloons and
there you go.
And animal noises, yeah.
But you also need, you know, I'm really proud that of our three astronauts in the European Space Agency, two are women and one is a guy with a prosthetic limb. So the UK is using astronaut program to champion diversity. And I think if we tell the story better, I think more people will be inspired and will break the old stereotypes.
Thank you. Aisha, from your experience, you know, primary school?
Primary school STEM wasn't really talked about much, and I'm probably not the best person because I go to an all-girl school, but I know the benefits of being around all girls because secondary school, it wasn't about, oh, you're not as good as the boys. It was about, okay, I need to be better than this girl in my class and I need to beat her now. It was a competition among girls. And it wasn't until I went to my first in-person STEM events that I realized I was actually a minority. But naturally, the girls usually end up clustering together and then you end up talking. But yeah, definitely, if you encourage girls to get into STEM early and you show them that they can find community within each other, it really does benefit them because my experience in an all-girls school, my sixth form is mixed, but my classes are still mostly full of girls. I am the majority, and I don't feel like there's no space for me. Mm. I know that I fit here, and no one could tell me otherwise.
Fantastic. Michael?
Yeah, like, education from four upwards has a series of issues. I'd agree that there needs to be more men in primary school education. Around the age of six is when stereotypes start to kick in. But when it comes to STEM, because the way STEM is taught in primary schools, I think, is not really delineated. So students are usually fine until about 11. In secondary schools are where things get much worse. It's good to go to an all-girls school, because if you go to an all-girls or a single-sex school, and we focus on all-girls schools, you aren't able to stereotype based on gender who is going to be good or bad at maths or physics or chemistry, because you only have one gender there. So you just pick the people who are talented. So it means that in reality, there are biases within the system in most schools that force people away from some STEM subjects. And it will start within society for kids at six, and then within schools specifically from 11 to 18. And then to go to the nursing question, again, yeah, it's an easy one, isn't it? Because yes, for all the reasons that have already been said, we really need to focus on the positive aspects of having nurses as a career. My father was a nurse. He loved it whilst he was nursing. I think that there is a strange kind of elitist system within the country as a whole, which says that some things are better than others. It is represented in the way that we compensate people, but it is also represented in the way that we actually just treat individuals. And I think that also needs to change.
Bob, you're a social scientist. What's your perspective on these questions?
Well, I'm a geologist who works with social scientists, as they often remind me. I think the gender stereotyping of subjects is something that we've been tackling for a long, long time. And young people come under pressures from all different aspects, you know, and trying to just do this through, say, schools is just not going to work, right? you know, if you come from a family where your parents kind of have expectations of what kind of job you should be doing and what kind of profession, then the school is, you know, you don't want the school kind of running into conflict. So we kind of need a very different approach here to, as I said, about status and expectations of it and what a meaningful career looks like. And that means challenging a lot of things. I do agree that the focus should be much more on boys and getting boys to change their attitudes than it is on girls. It seems that we put a lot of pressure on girls and women to kind of fight against a kind of a system that's often stacked against them when it's the boys and the men who are responsible for maintaining those things. And so it is right that we should be having a much broader conversation, I think, about, you know, I don't want to expand the conversation too far, about masculinity, what it's like to, what it is to be a man and a boy, which affects expectations in life, including about their career, but so much more. So many of our problems in society these days we see are about men who can't cope with society. And that's a much more fundamental problem, I think, and of which stereotyped ideas about careers is one aspect of it.
I think it's a fantastic point. It is about that push and that pull. But I do wonder, I think there is something about, you know, being the change that you want to see in the world. And it's something I get quite a lot. You know, I've run Stemettes for 10 years and I have a lot of people being like, you know, what about the boys? And I'm like, okay, cool. You're a man. What have you done for the boys? You know, how are you working with them? How are you inspiring them? When have you met a nurse? When have you respected the nurses, the male nurses in your life? You know, where's the work that you've done? But I think it is an interesting one as well, Michael, to draw on that idea of informal spaces. And I think we have this, you know, for sport, we have this for music quite a lot. You know, a lot of folks that are in the music industry haven't studied music and gone into it via that. And so how do we allow us to have different routes into science, different ways for folks to engage? You meet a lot of people that will say, you know, they don't like maths because of the experience that they had with their maths teacher. I wonder how many of you have met people that don't listen to music because of their relationship with their music teacher. No, and I think there is something about opening up those pathways, those spaces, and allowing people to engage with whatever the possibilities might be outside of formal spaces as well as inside formal spaces. Ali, I wanted to bring you in again on this. What can we learn from sport about attitudes that are formed in people's childhood? You know, something like sport as well, you've got professional sport, you've got sport for leisure, you've got lots of different kind of grades and shades of it. You know, tell us the answer.
Yeah, oh gosh, no pressure. I mean, from my own experience, so I've loved football since I could walk, like true story, but I was of that generation that was told, no, this is a male space, it's not for you. And so it was decades later that I created space for myself and for other women like me to enjoy the sport. So I think the perception has changed so much in this country around sport, and we've got such brilliant sports women that links to that whole, if you can see it, you can be it. But I think in terms of what we can learn from sport, I think it's just around saying, allowing us to be more creative, that not, in sport, there isn't really a right or wrong in that there are rules of the game, and as long as you play by those rules of whatever sport you're in, you can be really creative within those rules. And I think that I will always come back to that creativity point. I think the activities that you've discussed in lab tots, that's amazing. But let's keep that creativity, because I've worked in high performance environments in football as well, where it's equally important for those players, even if they're elite adults at the top of their game, they still need to have fun. So you will have watched, like during the men's Euros, you'll have watched the England men's team throwing around this rubber chicken as part of their warm-up, and you're like, what? They're all paid like unreasonable amounts of money to kick a ball about, and they're just flinging this rubber chicken around. But that's them having fun, and that's because Gareth Southgate surrounded himself by experts from other fields who said, these guys need to know how to let off steam because they've got like the weight of the nation on them to win a football game. Priorities. So I think, yeah, it's about saying, let's create spaces where it's okay to fail, because that's how we learn and that's how we ultimately thrive.
Rubber chickens, right, writing that one down as well. You know,
yeah. Good team, play with the football.
There you go. Yeah, there we go. Free fun food has always been our thing at Stemette. So free food is the other one that we find goes very far, which we've got here today. Unfortunately, not for those of you on the broadcast. So our final question we're going to get from Sarah Chapman at 3M, who's down here.
Thank you. Young people will inherit a planet living with the consequences of climate change, a fossil fuel-based economy, and brands with not enough focus on using recycled materials and products that can be upcycled. What can young people do to influence decision-makers, brands, and local communities to bring about changes that actually tackle climate change? Thank you.
Youngest person.
She knew it was coming as well.
Stop asking me. Stop asking us, because I'm still in school. I'm in sixth form. I haven't finished yet. Not in university. Won't be a while till I'm able to do much. Maybe ask me for help, but don't expect me to make the changes. You guys messed it up. Please fix it.
Spoken like a true young person. There we go. Let's get on with it. Right, so she's passed the baton, which not as a young person is going to take it up. Bob, you are working in climate change, I know.
I am, and climate change is full of injustices, and one of the biggest is that the young people who have contributed in general least amount to the current problems are the ones who are going to have to live with the consequences for longest. And Aisha's absolutely right. It isn't right for people of my age and my generation to say, well, we screwed everything up. What are you going to do to fix everything? That's just not fair. The one thing that really worries me about when I talk to a lot of young people who are really unbelievably gifted communicators and focused on this issue, really have a very clear view. And they are, I have to say, sick to death of current power structures, including politics, which they feel is kind of completely avoiding all the things that really matter to them. And they prefer direct action, right? Because they see this is something I can do that really makes a difference. I have to say that that, unfortunately, is going to work against young people's best interests, because they have to seize back the power structures we have. And the most powerful thing I think you can do as a young person is write to your MP and say, what are you going to do about climate change? Because I have spoken to so many MPs who say, oh, I don't get any letters about climate change. I get letters about the bins and about, you know, I don't like wind farms and things like that. Nothing changes. I mean, George might correct me here, but nothing changes an MP's sense of sense of priorities and getting letters from people who are maybe too young to vote but are going to be future constituents, asking them, what are you going to do? And you don't have to kind of tell them the answer. You just get them thinking about it. Get engaged with, seize back the processes here. Don't just settle for direct action. Hold people accountable. Hold your local representatives, MPs, you know, local politicians, hold them accountable, engage, and make them respond to your priorities, because it's really those that are the things that we need to change radically at the moment. And actually, one of the easiest ways we let them off the hook is by thinking, oh, well, it's all down to what I choose in the supermarket. It really isn't, right? It's really about how we change the system, because it's the system that is the problem at the moment. It's just changing far too slowly.
Well, I'd love to. I completely echo and endorse that. The intergenerational justice is almost the biggest injustice of all. I'm reasonably confident that actually the ingenuity of mankind, science, technology, innovation, we will solve this. We will get to the point where we can harness renewables. We don't have to kill each other with pollution. And we'll look back and say, what were we doing from the moment when the science first became clear? For 20, 30 years, we did nothing, and then we raced a bit late. So I'm confident we'll get there, but we lost 20, 30 years. It's a bit like when, you know, everyone used to smoke in the 40s, 50s. They didn't know it was bad for you. When we knew it was bad for you, not everyone, but a lot of people said, that's absolutely mad. Well, we know this is bad for the planet. So the intergenerational bit, I completely agree. What can we do? What can young people do? One is, I mean, don't underestimate the consumer pound. And as young people start to spend, you can already see it. And I'm incredibly unfashionable, and I always like secondhand clothes. My children used to tease me. Now they buy all their clothes secondhand because they care. They don't want to support Chinese sweatshops. And as young people get older, which happens quite quickly, you'll drive the market. Secondly, employers. I run a festival, a non-political ideas festival, and a bunch of banks, big companies, corporates started coming. And I said, why are you coming? It's all young people on soapboxes. And they said, because we need to understand what the employees of tomorrow want. And they want values-based companies. They don't just want a placard. They want, and we need to re-engineer our companies. So don't underestimate the power of being positive, but being impatient. Thirdly, enterprise, on the recycling. I met a girl recently. She's a young woman. She's 17. And she started a little business online in County Durham for people who bought clothes on eBay. And I've got very long arms. They never quite fit. And she's worked out a lot of people need adjustments. So she's contacted all the older ladies, seamstresses, and said, would you... And she started a business for adapting clothes. So, I mean, never underestimate the power of starting a little venture. And write to your MPs and your councillors, by the way. Local councillors get overlooked. They normally win their seats by only about 100 votes. I mean, you can run councillors and really make your point. And most importantly, vote. I go to a school every Friday in my constituency, and it's the main issue that everyone talks about. And I think politics is quite broken, and they want to know that we're not going to do this through party politics, and we're going to do it as a national Olympic mission that everyone can be part of. And I totally endorse Bob. I understand why people are impatient and throwing paint at shops and stopping traffic. That won't help. It'll incubate a pushback by hardworking people who are trying to get to work in the morning. And young people, I think, can really embarrass and shame and speak and ask for progress. That's more powerful than throwing paint, actually.
Okay. Final comment from a panellist
I think I agree with both of what both people have said. I think that one of the things we should think about is why people aren't engaged in politics. And whether that's through kind of the power structures, the sense of kind of societal elitism we have whereby people don't see the impact or effect politics can have on their lives. That definitely needs to change. I'm heartened to hear you say that we should encourage young people to talk, to write to MPs and to councillors to try and create change. But I think we do really need to think about why they aren't currently already doing it. And if we can think about that and solve that problem, then we probably would have a probably happier group of people who can see that they have the effect they want to have on the society.
I think as a note to add to this as well as we head into our final remarks. So at Stemette, we are, Hannah's going to be joining actually. The BSA has partnered with us. We're doing some research and looking into a letter that's been written by three of our Stemettes this year to ask the Department for Education to upgrade the national STEM curriculum to ensure that we've got more women's names across the syllabus. And it's really interesting, actually, we got a response from the minister this morning that was not necessarily a satisfactory response. So we're going to embark on more letter writing. Maybe we'll add a couple of councillors into the fray. You're going to get a copy of the letter now, George, that I've seen you, because it was not satisfactory. But yeah, keep going. Pair up, you know, partner up with other organisations, with other young people, and make sure that you do push for the change that you want to see. Because as Bob has said, even though you're not voting yet, this is your life, right? And so we've got to make sure that the power structures that be are representing and are reflecting that. Because, yeah, in another however many years, it might not necessarily be George that sat there, but we still need to make sure that systemically we've had those changes, we've made those edits for our benefits. So we're almost out of time. I'm going to ask each of the panellists, we're going to start with you, Bob, for your final reflections, your closing remarks, your closing thoughts on what we've covered today.
Yeah, I think... you don't have to be a scientist to benefit from science and learning. Science is not about a bunch of facts. It's about learning how to do something. It's a rigorous way of thinking about problems and learning about the world. And whether or not you want a career in science, science can help you no matter what your career is. Part of this problem of stereotyping of scientists is that we have a very narrow conception of what a scientist is. Well, I consider myself to be a scientist, and I spend most of my day arguing with journalists and politicians, right? And we need more people with science backgrounds in every aspect of life, because it's really important, because people who do science think about the world in a very rigorous way. Our whole world is based on our understanding of science. Without science, we wouldn't have civilization. We'd still be trying to work out how to create fire, right? So no matter what your background, whether you want a career in science and be a scientist, just find that part of science that you really like and learn about it. Not about the facts, but about how you think about things. Because, you know, we've faced with lots of challenges in life. We've just been through a pandemic, which has really been about to what extent we understand science and apply it. And we have lots of these problems, climate change, air pollution, you know, all these things all depend ultimately on how well we use science to solve these problems. So go and seize this opportunity.
Thank you, Bob. Michael.
Yeah, so I think that whilst we are progressing or trying to create systemic change, one of the things that we have to try and do is empower everyone to understand that, like, politics isn't about politicians. Politics is for everyone. And everyone in some way is a politician. In the same way that science and engineering isn't just about learning science and engineering, it's for everyone. And in some way, everyone is a scientist and an engineer. I think that's really, really important to get across, because all these things impact your everyday lives. So you're doing them or learning about them without you ever really, sometimes ever realizing. I think we've talked a little bit about school and university, and to reflect back on what George said earlier about trying to infuse people with facts, one of the difficulties that schools will have is the space in the curriculum. And I think that curricula needs to be more inclusive. You can say, if you to use George's example, the amazing thing about a bird is it will fly around the world and come back to the same space. The problem we have is that not all students will find that amazing. Mm-hmm. Only some will, whereas we have the space within higher education to have a discussion about what every individual student will find amazing, and then let them focus inclusively on that part of the bird's journey or the bird itself that they find, to use an example. I think we really should be doing better in higher education to be more inclusive, because there isn't enough space in the curriculum in like the earlier key stages to be inclusive. That's, yeah.
Thank you, Michael. Aisha.
Don't let school stop your love for learning. It's fun to learn new things. I've gone out of my way to find things outside of STEM, inside of STEM. Explore as much as you can through podcasts, read some books, look at the news, pick a newspaper. Learning is fun. It's hard to say this out loud. It sounds really nerdy, as people may call it, but it's fun, it's enjoyable. It shouldn't stop within school, and there's always going to be something for you.
I love that all the teachers are in the room were like, don't let school stop your desire to learn. No, I love that. I guess just, obviously, I am not the scientist in the room. I think that's become apparent. But from my career as a coach, my approach was always built around three key things, and that was engage, educate, and empower. And the way that I did that was I made it fun. So I engaged them by getting to know them as an individual and understanding what was fun to them, like Michael was saying. I educated them by challenging them. There's a myth a lot of the time that we all just want everything to be nice. No, we don't. We want to be challenged. We want to make things better. And I empowered them by making it safe. And a lot of that is linked to that psychological safety that I've talked about a lot, in terms of it's okay to get this wrong, because that's how we're going to learn. So that's kind of, if I can offer any advice to any of the scientists that want it, that's how I would go about engaging young people.
Thank you, Ali. Minister Freeman.
Well, thank you. What a great evening. It's British Science Week we're kicking off, and I answer the question with 3 points. The first thing is to just, all of us who get it and believe in it, keep telling the story that science is fundamental to understanding the great questions of life, the origins of life, the planet, how it works, the things that all of us share. It's fundamental to our shared humanity. And Even if you're not a bench scientist, all of us rely on science, and it's fundamental to our long-term future. And that the scientific mindset is not boring. It's about asking some really big questions, like, what is the origin of life? How did this planet come to be here? What is driving climate change? So really big questions. I think we often focus on the process of answering it, not celebrate the question. You are allowed to ask big questions. Secondly, I think it's British Science Week, and you'd expect me to say this, I think, but it needs saying. This country is a great science power around the world. And the great challenges we face, from feeding 9 billion mouths, doubling world food production on half the land area with the same water and energy, from preventing climate change to mitigating it, to understanding how we clean up the oceans, clean up space, stop 100 million people walking out of Africa. Science is fundamental to this, and the Brits, the Scots, the Northern Irish, the Welsh, the English, together the Brits, the UK is respected around the world. And as your science minister internationally, it's an incredible privilege. And, you know, I think be proud and tell the story. This country is punching well above its weight across the board. And finally, I would say that, and people ask me in Parliament, I've done 12 years and I've just focused on science, technology, research, innovation. I was Minister for Life Science, Minister for Agricultural Science, Minister for Transport Technology, and then Minister for all of science. And often MPs say, why? Why are you so obsessed with science? Well, the answer is, in the end, I don't think we will tackle the Great Depression. And I mean the depression in our society. Young people have never been more depressed. The science is clear. And I think people are depressed because they feel powerless and they feel as though the great problems facing our society are beyond resolution and beyond them. And I think the science mindset fundamentally says, no, I reject that. We can change this. And I think it's fundamental to giving hope both for Britain in the world, for the world in Britain, and for people in this country. And that's why I'm just absolutely determined to spread the science research, innovation and technology piece all around the country. We have a golden triangle, Oxford, Cambridge, London, but in Glasgow, the Space City, in Edinburgh, in Belfast, in Swansea, in Cardiff, in Warwick Robotics, in Cornwall, in Norwich Agritech, we're home to amazing science, and the social sciences, the humanities, the design sciences, they're all around the country. And I think it's the only way we're going to get out of debt, give young people a chance to believe in this country and have a go at taking back control of their destiny, their planet and their future. And it should be much more inspiring than we make it.
Thank you very much. Now, as I bring this panel to a close, I'm reminded there's a slide I take into schools. I get to visit schools very often. My final slide is almost always a picture of a pug with the caption, you haven't chosen the pug life has chosen you. And I think it's important for us to reflect on that actually life in the 21st century means that science, technology, engineering and maths and the arts and design are everywhere. They're ubiquitous. They're part of how you can understand the world around you. They're part of how you have your own agency and you have your own power as well in life as it is at the moment. Science is creative. Science is about solving problems and helping people. And science is incredibly diverse. So we've got to remember that you don't have to be dead and young, dead and male and white and have a beard in order to contribute to science. You can be, as Michael said, cool like me, and also a scientist. And with that, I will bring proceedings to a close. Thank you very much to those of you who have joined us virtually as well. The recording will be available on the British Science Association YouTube, and highlights will also be on the BSA website. If anyone would like to find out more about British Science Week, which we can say we've officially launched, yes, as with this event, then please visit britishscienceweek.org. I'm Anne-Marie, I've been your president of the British Science Association. I'd like to hand over to Hannah, CEO, for our final words.
I knew it would be a brilliant discussion, and it really was. Thank you so much. I wanted to just start by saying a huge thank you to this evening's panel, to Aisha, Kukoyi, Ali Speechley, Michael Sulu, Bob Ward, Minister George Freeman, and of course, our President, Anne-Marie Imafidon. Thank you also again to our sponsors, UKRI, 3M, MSD, and Urenco. And a huge thank you to the brilliant British Science Association team, especially for Anissa, who I think I can see up there, for masterminding this evening's event. And our photography exhibition at London Bridge Station, which if you haven't already seen, make sure you go home that way. And to Lily, who is up there, for leading our fantastic Smashing Stereotypes campaign. And thank you, Aisha, for the plug for that earlier. So for those who are on live stream, I don't know if you're still on live stream, I hope you have a great rest of the evening. And for those in the audience here, I hope you will join us for drinks and canapés and further discussion. Thank you so much.